Hello everyone, it's Richard here. Today we're going to be looking at the LulzBot Taz6 3D printer. So after the TCT show, I was chatting to the LulzBot team and they kindly sent me through a Taz6 for review, comment and general feedback really. Obviously it's been around for a little while already, well established itself as an award winner on 3D Hubs and generally is a really sound and solid printer. They've designed it very well for global approvals, and it comes ready built. It's still open source and it's still rep wrap if you like. There are some 3D printed parts in it, so let's see what we actually have been sent. Now, I did request the new hot end, which I'll explain a little bit more in a minute. So hopefully, I really haven't opened this package yet, so I don't know what's in there, but we're going to find out in just a few seconds. First of all, they also sent me some materials, so I've quickly opened those, but we will go through what they've sent me, because they asked what materials I'd like to review or I'd like to look at with the 3D printer. And actually, I picked ones that are difficult to get in this country, difficult to get in the UK or Europe. So we'll have a quick look. Here we go. So the first material, we've got Chroma Strand Labs. And this is a premium 3D printing filament. So this is, if I remember rightly, yep, here we go. So this is copolyester. 3D printing filament. So this is with amphora, Eastman amphora in. So it's a little bit like the ColourFab range, ColourFab XT range of 3D printing filament. So that'll be really interesting to try out. I've not used this brand before and I've seen it around. You know, other people comment about it, but it'd be really good to find out what that is like. So the next one, Verbatim. Now, I should be able to get hold of this, but it's been a little tricky. There's not that many places that stock it. I probably, yes, could have got hold of this, but because they were very keen to send me a few bits of few materials, this was another one I recommended that I would quite like to try out. So I've not used Verbatim materials before, but I've heard very good things. So again, interesting to try. Okay, this one's very interesting. So this is a Tolman Envent, and it's the only Tolman material that I've not yet tried. So it's the very last Tolman material to try out. So it'll be really interesting to see what Envent is like. Okay, and the last one is, yes. So we've just got standard LulzBot Blue ABS, which is pretty good because that's the sort of thing they ship with the machine and what you can get off of their website. So we'll pop those back in there for now and then take a look at the actual Taz6. So first of all, if you saw my previous video, you'll know it comes in a massive box. So I've got this box and I've had to bring in another table here to actually put it all on and unpack it for this unboxing video. So here we go. Wow. This is the very large Taz6 box. It's blocking out all my light. Here we go. So I really haven't broken any of these seals, haven't opened it. Okay. Oh, it's looking really nice. We've got, looks like, oh yeah, one of the sticky handles has come off. Not really important. Okay, that's looking quite well packed. It's got a lot of high density foam in there. So I'm going to put this back down on the floor and then lift it out. That's probably the safest way. This is a very big 3D printer. It's not that heavy. It's probably heavier than most of the 3D printing boxes that I've got, but considering the size of it, I was expecting it to be slightly heavier. It's just very bulky, the actual box. Okay, so there's a box on the side, which looks like that's going to be toolkit, power cables, USB cable, SD card, filament guide, sample filament coil, LulzBot sticker, yay, test octopus print. So a quick look in there. Let's see what we've got. Oh wow, comes with a nice little, look at that. Oh, LulzBot bag. I didn't realise they sent those out, sent all the kit out in a little bag like that. That's very nice. So we've got, looks like we've got the whole collection of power cords, which is always useful. A little bit wasteful, but we've got US one, we've got UK, and we've got European. So I guess they just realised it's probably easier just to send out all of them and not be too worried or concerned about having all of them in there. Okay, so we've got another pack on top that's stuck on there, which is manuals and, yeah, it looks like guide, filament guide and manuals, which is great. Oh, I can see where the other handle, box handle comes from now. These are for you to lift it up with. They look like one fell off in transport, but not too much of a problem. So take out that cardboard. Don't normally do unboxing videos, but this was so nicely sealed and I knew I was going to be in for a treat opening up. I thought I would let you see as well. So there's another box, box two this is called, and this is the LulzBot Taz6 extruder tool head. So this comes in a separate box, I guess they don't fit it to the machine, you have to fit that separately. So we have the tool head all in there. Oh no, this is a bit of a disappointment because I was hoping for the new hot end, and they have revised the hot end that I saw at TCT. The new hot end, which is a shame, but I will talk about it a little bit more when we get into the 3D printer and some of the reasons why maybe they've changed over to a different hot end system. But I'll give it a good shot, because last time I used a hexagon hot end, admittedly it wasn't in a LulzBot printer, so we will see how it performs in here. Obviously, there's plenty of people using these in Taz's and LulzBot printers all around the world, so we will find out how I get on with that. I'm just a little disappointed that it didn't come with the new hot end, because that would have been something to get very excited about and talk to you about. Okay, so let's move on. We've got the printer to lift out now. And that looks fairly straightforward. It's quite big. And there's not a lot left in there. I think there's one more. No, there's one more empty packing piece. So that's good. So I can get rid of this box and give myself a little bit more room. Okay, so it looks like we've got a number of pieces of packaging to remove. And I should have said before, ignore all of the devastation in the background. My Sigma is slightly poorly at the moment, so it's going through a few fixes. And I've got some space already set up over here for the Taz to sit, so I can start doing some testing and obviously materials from 3D printing. Wow, okay, so that's interesting. They've got the Y axis assembly sort of slotted into the frame. That's all very nicely put. You can see, probably just about see. We got lots of tape, and yeah, I do like this nice box, little box on the side. Okay, so we'll, okay, let's read the warning label. Okay, so it's basically saying that we respect your freedom to modify and hack, I guess, your LulzBot desktop 3D printer. However, any modifications or attempted repairs that cause damage are not covered under warranty, which I guess is fair enough. You need to sort of know what you're doing if you're going to mess around with a 3D printer in the first place. And you shouldn't have to change too much on this 3D printer to have a good experience of it actually working. So we'll leave it as stock to do all of the testing, and then I'll think about how I would actually modify bits of it a little bit later on. Okay, it's obviously not quite designed to come out of that way. At this point I should probably get the manuals out and read how to unpack it, but it shouldn't be too difficult. I can see, yep, there's some packaging at the bottom, so that's what I'm going to do now. turn this around. I see. So that's all held nicely in. Okay, there's one bit of tape to remove to get the cables out for the Y axis. I should be able to lift that out. There we go, there it is. So that's our assembled Y axis. You can see we have got some 3D printed parts on the end, and it's actually quite, it's heavy, but it's lighter than it looks. It looks very heavy, but it's actually fairly straightforward. Very nice. We've got some slidey IGUS bushings as well on there, which is quite interesting, instead of using bearings, so it should help keep the noise down. I'm going to put this over here. Okay, so we've only got one more bit of packing material to come off. And we're done. Put this back round and start with the assembly. Okay. Wow, it's looking very nice. So we've now got the LulzBot Taz6 unpacked. It all looks in good condition, there's no damage. Packaging was very, very good. Obviously, a lot of these ship from the US to international customers all around the world. They do have a lot of distributors and distribution points. This one came from London, so it didn't have very far to travel to me, but they're obviously all assembled and made over in the US. So this did start its life off with an international trip of some description. So it's done very well. The packaging is held up and everything looks intact. So I'm going to go on and assemble the Y-axis into it, actually look at the instruction manual and just check that I'm doing everything correctly, because, yeah, just want to make sure it's all set up as per a normal user would expect when they get their Taz6. So I just opened up the Taz instruction manuals, the Taz6 instruction manuals, and there was some safety and warning checks and various other things. What's really interesting is, obviously, there is a start here guide, which I should have followed. But it just basically tells you how to get it out of the box nicely. It's a very nice printed, fully full colour printed manual. It tells you all about how to unbox your Taz. What packaging parts to remove in what order, which is great. And generally just how to unbox it, how to take all the tape off. So for anyone with literally just no experience at all, takes you through every tiny little aspect. And I guess that's more important when you start coming to the points of slackening off nuts to bolt on the Y-axis and fitting connectors and cables and things, because there's not a lot to do to set this machine up. But anyone that's not, you know, fully technically familiar with these types of systems, that's great to see that we've got literally a full guide all the way through, right the way, you know, all the way through to power on at the end. So powering on your LulzBot Taz. And yeah, it's quite nice that this was actually created with 100% full free Libre software, which is nice. And LulzBot are famous for having virtually every system they run under free open source systems. So we've got a few safety and warnings. Most people would probably ignore most of those, which you probably shouldn't. But one of the things right at the end, it says, keep attended, never leave the 3D printer unattended. And I guess that's something that's really tricky with a machine this size, with the size of things you're going to print. How are you never going to leave it unattended? So that's one of those questions, really, that you're not going to sit there watching it for 27 hours when it's printing a massive object. But generally, yeah, don't go away and leave your 3D printer on. It's really, really bad idea. Shock hazard, fire hazard, burn hazard, it's all there just to make you aware of it. Declaration of conformity. It's nice to see this because I know this machine's been fully FCC approved and EMC, and it follows all of the directives. And actually, they've gone to the trouble of listing them all out and signing at the bottom, Jeff Moe, CEO, to say that it is conforming to that compliance. CE is an interesting one, obviously, for UK and Europe, but CE is basically a self-certification system. It's most people think it's an approval standard, but actually it is a requirement for sales of anything this type of nature into the UK and Europe. But CE itself is more down to your processes and understanding and have full documentation of the product and all of the parts in there. And at the end of the day, it's for the company to self-certify that this is safe. You can have third-party people come in and certify or help you approve, although that's the wrong word, certify that your product is CE compliant. But actually, at the end of the day, you've got to decide that you're happy that you've made all the necessary safety precautions you can for CE certification, if you like. So the other thing, we've got a little checklist on there of power cords and sample stickers and everything else, all the things that should have been in the box. And I think everything is. And a little test sheet as well, test and acceptance sheet, which is nice to see. Seeing this more and more on 3D printers, whether it's an automatically printed one or something done by a human that's actually gone through a procedure. And there's quite a lot in here that they have to check before they actually go through and accept that the 3D printer is ready to be sent out. So it's really nice to see that. And of course, you can also, when you set it all up, go through that same procedure and just check that everything feels okay and everything measures to the same diameters and things and same distances as Mike found when he completed that test, which is really nice. So I'm going to carry on now and get this all set up and hopefully get us printing very soon. Well, that was very easy. Connecting the y-axis to the frame is literally a case of, after you take the packaging off, just dropping it down onto the ready-made feet that are already sort of aligned and set up, and everything fits very nicely, very perfectly, feels very, very solid. This whole machine, everything you touch about it feels professional and solid. Just any movement it makes, any of the parts, they all just fit together really nicely. So then you just put the thumb screws in, and LulzBot are one of the companies that I've seen put inserts into, threaded inserts into the plastic parts to actually give a really nice threaded bolt effect into 3D printed parts. It makes it a little bit harder for individuals to replicate those parts because you have to fit those threaded inserts, but you can get them, in packs, and you can insert them in with usually a hot soldering iron. So you put the brass threaded insert onto the end of your soldering iron, which warms it up. You don't have to have it too hot, and then you push it into the plastic, which fuses it into the plastic and allows nuts and bolts to be actually sort of screwed in. So they've done that on the y-axis here, which is really nice that, again, we're using 3D printed parts and off-the-shelf parts as well. So once that's bolted in, really the instructions then just tell you to connect everything up. The motor at the back is very easy just to plug in. Everything sort of just falls into place, so there shouldn't be really any confusion about how to plug in the various different connectors. There's a lot of connections going to the moving y-axis because there are not only a few sensors and things on there, you've also got obviously the power to the heated bed, and it is a very large heated bed. It looks like we've got a PEI top surface, glass, and then a silicon heater underneath, which I must admit, until now, I didn't realise it used a silicon heater. I didn't pay that much attention. And I've had some silicon heaters debond themselves from the backs of glass different machines, small and large. So this is quite a large one. It looks like it's very, very well bonded and insulated and supported. So we'll see what that will give me, and there's a nice solid piece of aluminium on the bottom there as well. So we've just got a few things to connect up, and it looks like basically they just go really as you'd expect, connector to connector. There's not a lot you can do to get that wrong, he says. There's also a little plastic clip there that you add some tie wraps in at the end to just lock the cable in place. Okay, so that one clips on nicely. Yeah, they're all nice locking, positive locking connections, which is great to see, really, because that means that you're not going to make too many errors. And because it's a moving Y axis, you don't want too many things to obviously be moving around that aren't clicked and locked in place. So there's three main connections: a multi-way, a power, and I think that must be the bed sensor, which is the two-way connector, which I'm having a few problems locking in place. I think that's, no, it's not locked. Oh, I see. Sorry. Slightly misaligned pin. But we can fix that. Yeah, a tiny bit of misalignment on the pin. So I'm just going to move that slightly. Ah, there we go. Perfect. So it's nice and locked in place now. Okay. And it looks like it just wants you to click it in place into the 3D printed touch sensor at the left hand side. Okay, so that's going to make a lot more sense when I turn it around the other way. It's looking almost set up now. A few more checks and pages on the manual. I think we'll be ready. Obviously we've got to fit the extruder next. So that's the next job. Again, comes all pre-assembled, set up ready with just a wiring cable loom that you can connect together. So this one doesn't look like it's positive locking, but it is polarized, so you can't get it the wrong way around. They do actually have little green triangles that you line up, but yeah, I mean, it's a reasonably quick fit as well. They sort of latch on and you screw at the top, so that's quite an easy one I saw at the show. What's really nice with the tools that come included is that you get a full set of Allen keys. You don't need all of these sizes, but it's nice to have a full set, keep with your 3D printer. And also that indicates that everything on this 3D printer, as far as I understand, is metric as well. I've had a few 3D printers from America and Canada that have been imperial measurements and very odd sizes of nuts, bolts, screws. And it took me ages to actually find a set of Allen keys for old imperial. Well, I say old, it's still obviously used in some parts of the world. But it's nice to see that this printer is at least metric and uses standard Allen keys. So the last job I'm doing now is putting on the extruder. And it says for you to use a 2.5mm Allen key, which is what I'm going to do. Play out of there. And take this one off. It's just a small bolt at the top that again goes into one of the little brass fittings. Got a washer on as well, and this just locks in the tool head, which in this case is the plastic extruder, but you could put other tool heads on. You could have a paste extruder, you could have a machining tool head. This is strong enough machine to actually take for milling, laser etching, maybe even laser cutting, but at the moment obviously 3D printing tool head. So we're going to clip that on, and it just sort of sits. Feels a little bit loose, but I guess that's the whole point of just putting that screw back in and locking it up tight. And you're going to get the final bit of alignment done anyway once you put this back on. So we just drop that down. Because the carriage is all the way up at the top, I guess this is just the way they ship it, but you've got no real way of moving that down. And it's a little tricky to get this one in. You've got, obviously, the Allen key has got two ends, the long end and the short end, so it's not that difficult. Okay, so that's all locked in. And the only other thing to do is connect up. And, oh, that's interesting. So yeah, they've actually taken out one of the pins, which is sort of standard for polarizing connectors. So you can't get them the wrong way around. But what you normally do is put a blanking pin in the other end of the connector, so physically you can't actually put the two connectors together. And all they've done is just, there's a missing crimp in the other side. So I would have liked to have seen, there's little tiny blanking pins you can push into those connectors, and that means that, yes, they have the two green arrows that you line up, but if they had that little blanking pin, it would be impossible for someone to actually put that connector in the wrong way round. So I might suggest that, well, I'm suggesting it now as an alternative to actually just leaving that pin missing. So, but we will push them in with the connectors, green connector, all lined up. And I guess that just sits there like that. So it's all got strain relief at the top, which is quite nice. And that's it. I'm pretty much connected all together. Everything else comes pre-wired. All of the Z-axis is already wired up and configured and routed through into the connectors all inside, which is running the electronics to run the 3D printer. So the next thing to do is just double check. Let's see what our next steps are on our manual. Yep, connecting up. Oh, I've already done the spool lever at the side. We've got a little lever that comes down, locks down, and then side filament guide tube. Aha, I've seen that. So we have a filament guide tube that we're going to slide on, and where's that going to go? That looks like it clips. Oh yeah, okay. At the back, I see. Move this around. So we've got this lever at the side, and that's where you're going to put your spool, your filament spool, and then the guide back here. Take another piece off. Once we've got that off, we can lever that down. Push our guide tube into there. There, yeah, okay. So, tube goes upwards. It just gives you the guide through. Okay, that's nice. So that can just sit there. And then, check that every connector is fully fitted and properly connected. So now we're at the point of powering on your LulzBot Taz, which is quite exciting. So I should get a power lead and do that. So almost every power supply you get in these sort of machines are now multi-world, but some of them do have, not this machine, I don't believe, I will double check. Yeah, 100 to 240 volts, so this is a wide operating voltage range. But some of them do, just be aware that in some 3D printers you do have a switch for US 110 or UK European 220 to 240. So we can put this one in. And plugged it in, turned it on. Got a few little fans coming on. Another fan. Ramps up and then ramps down again. So that's good. It's nice and quiet. Certainly not a tornado. Or anything too loud. Okay. Everything looks good. It's reading ambient temperatures. It's pretty cool here in the UK at the moment, so it's only 17 degrees C. Could do with a bit more temperature, a bit more heat. And now we're at the end of our getting set up, starting here guide. So we have our 3D printer, and I guess we're hoping to achieve first print, something along the lines of the sample print you get with the printer, which is a little octopus. So we've got some wonderful LulzBot. Oh yeah, there's some NGen, so that's an unfair ColourFab engine that comes with it. And we've also got high performance HT, high temperature PLA from Protopasta as samples that come. Oh, that's nice. That's sort of a smoky. Oh, I like that one. I've not seen that before. That's a smoky black. Excellent. Try that one out. So I think I'm going to move this over to my shelf that I've got set up for it and actually get a first print. So I was just clearing up at the back, ready to put the Taz6 into my testing station, and just came across one of the 3D printing projects I've done. I do quite a lot of 3D printing projects, and I don't always talk about them or blog or do things, but this one's quite an interesting one that you might, maybe I should do a blog post or a video about. But this was a little retro gaming controller that I 3D printed and used some off the shelf parts as well. So this has got an E-Pegger gaming controller that I've basically just cut and bonded to a 3D printed case. And the 3D printed case has got a mini PC, mini 5-inch screen, Windows 10 PC. It's got multi-boot, so it can do Android and Windows. But yeah, it's a nice little thing and quite easy to actually do these sorts of things. And it gives you a nice little handheld gaming console that you can use, do all your Windows and other sort of emulators and that sort of thing. So it's something that's a bit of a fun project to do. It didn't take very long to actually model up this case design and actually print it out. It was just a sort of a test to see whether I could actually sort of print an enclosure with a little mini Windows PC instead of using a tablet, because a lot of people just put a tablet onto these types of controllers. But actually I wanted something that was a little bit more self-contained. It's also quite nice as well because the Windows PC is in a little metal sort of pre-approved box. You don't really want to be taking that out and re-enclosuring it, because that's all nice and FCC compliant and won't emit too much radiation, all that sort of thing. So it's quite nice to keep all that in there. And actually the controller is Bluetooth, so there's no actual direct connection. So you just drop this in at the back, screw the screws in, and the Bluetooth just connects and you can just use it. It's got a battery in the main mini PC and a battery, lithium battery, in the controller. So self-contained, runs for about 4 or 5 hours and allows you to just have a few little retro game fun. So maybe I'll talk about that at some other time, but yeah, I could go through process of doing those types of little 3D printing projects. If anyone's interested, maybe leave me a comment down below in the comments section.